Hey guys, this is Patrick from STH, and today we're going to talk about an edge computing platform that I think is really cool. And specifically, you know, STH has been working on edge network computing platforms for years. I mean, we really started back in 2013 in earnest with the Intel Atom C2000 launch. We had the Atom C3000, we've done Xeon D1500, 2100 series, and we've done a lot of those really edge kind of UCPE type of devices. And so something that we wanted to look at is, well, what happens when you go that next step higher? And not just to something that's a little bit higher for a UCPE purpose, but also what if you need to do things like edge analytics because you have a retail location, you want to start putting cameras and start doing AI analytics on that. What happens when you have a cell tower and you need to go and put some compute at the bottom of the cell tower to start doing some of those radio functions? Now, a few weeks ago, we actually looked at the Supermicro IP65, or outdoor edge system, which is really cool. And we talked about a system that you could stick on a pole and that does a lot of these types of functions. But there's already an existing infrastructure around 19-inch racks, both in large stores like grocery stores, a lot of times will have a 19-inch rack. And you also see them at the bottom of different radio towers. Now, if we go out to our local radio tower, we can actually see that there's a little building at the bottom. And in that building, there's often telecom equipment. And that telecom equipment helps run the radio networks, runs all the access networks, all that kind of stuff that you might need if you have a radio tower and you need to go to a backhaul back to a carrier network. Now, something especially in that market has changed, and that specifically is that a lot of the guys that have been building these things in terms of service providers have said, hey guys, all of those really expensive Ericsson machines that are proprietary that we've purchased for years, in this generation, in the 5G generation, we don't want to do that model again. The closed proprietary things that we get locked into, that's probably not what we really want to do in terms of building out our entire network. And so those service providers are actually looking at what ways can we build machines and infrastructure that is more open, and we can actually just use open source tools. We can go build all of the stuff that we need without getting locked into a specific vendor. And while the Xeon D series, especially the 2100 series, was really designed for that, you know, that Xeon D series hasn't been updated since 2017. And at this point, some people want new features. And there's been Cascade Lake, which is some speculative execution fixes. It also has things like VNNI for edge inferencing. And so there's a lot of features that you get with the newer, bigger chips. So on my recent visit to Supermicro, one of the ideas we had was, why don't we go look at something not only that has one of those chips, but also maybe has some of the FPGA accelerators that are used for that kind of higher speed networking. And so let's get in the car and go look at one of these solutions. So I'm headed over straight down 237 right now. And the purpose of this is that we're actually going to go take a look at some products that I would normally take a look at during trade show coverage. But because we don't have trade shows this year, we didn't get to go do. Now, I got to send Supermicro a list of all the products that I wanted to go look at. I got to, you know, make that list myself. I get to say whatever the heck I want, but Supermicro said that they'd get the products for me. They'd also get as many product managers as were feeling comfortable coming into the office as soon as the shelter in place order was over. Now, just for full disclosure here, Supermicro did provide the products because we're going to do it in their demo room. They're providing the office space. They're also filming. The one thing that's going to be interesting is we have to wear masks in this video because we're going to be in the office and corporate policy says we have to wear masks. So get ready for that. So this is the Supermicro 1019P, and it's interesting for a couple reasons. First, it's a short depth chassis and it's a short depth server, which, you know, there's a lot of short depth servers out there. But what makes this particularly interesting is that it has two features that you don't see everywhere. And examples of those are, one, it uses the Intel Xeon Scalable Cascade U-Series. Hey, just quick interjection here. Since we're talking about the Xeon Gold U-Series, we should probably explain what that is because there are a lot of people that have no idea that this even exists. Now, STH was actually the first site that really kind of published anything on the U-Series, but the U-Series specifically is designed for single socket server applications. So there are a lot of servers that you don't necessarily need two sockets. You want to stay on one NUMA node, one socket. And Intel actually said, hey, you know, now that there's competition in the market, what we're going to do is we're going to do something like the AMD EPYC P-Series where we're going to have a single socket only processor. And what they basically did was they took higher end processors, they made them single socket only, and they offered huge discounts on them, which makes them very attractive. In fact, if you compare the U-Series Xeon Gold to something like a Xeon D2100 series. Now, 2100 series is embedded, and there's a lot of differences. But still, if you do a direct comparison, what you're going to see is just for the x86 cores, the U series is much less expensive. So those are the processors that we're talking about that are specifically designed and are actually a really good fit for a platform like this.
The second thing that it's also designed for is that it uses the Intel N3000 FPGA card, which is this right here. And this is actually a 100 gigabit networking card that also has an FPGA in there for acceleration. And so, hey, we have Yaming here, who's one of the, or is the PM for this box. And maybe you could just kind of give us some idea in terms of who are the typical customers that you see for a solution like this?
Yeah, thanks, Patrick. So specifically today, we have several customers are actually using this for trial, and they are more interested in getting this, getting hold of this box. The application is for telco operators, radio access network. So the telco customers is going through a transformation when they move to 5G. And there's a concept called Open RAN, so Open Radio Access Network, to use standard IT server with some specialized card for real-time processing to replace the proprietary equipment from Ericsson, Huawei of the world.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so what you're really getting is you're getting benefits from the lower cost U processor in the short depth chassis, and you're getting this N3000 solution. And I know, you know, Intel, and we've covered this a couple times, but that's a big push for Intel in this space.
Yeah. So really this box typically will go into the, we call the cell set equipment for acting as a distributed unit. Distributed unit is the one, it used to be called baseband unit, but with the Open RAN, they kind of separated into several things. I wouldn't go too much detail into that, but this box is connecting to the radio unit up on the power. Underneath the cell set, there's a cabinet. This one will fit in there because there's a limited real estate space, so it needs to be short depth, and typically it's a 19-inch width.
So if you're not up on the world of edge networking and FPGAs, you may wonder why we're making such a big deal over this N3000 pack. So years ago, Intel bought a company called Altera, which was probably the biggest FPGA company out there. And the typical FPGA model was that a company like an Ericsson would go buy an FPGA, they would put it into their custom solution, they design it in, and that's just where it would reside. But what Intel has done, and what you're starting to see in the FPGA space more, is that these FPGAs are actually being put on PCIe cards, they're being hooked up to the network, and they're doing functions and network functions before they even hit the x86 processor. A really good example of that is that Microsoft Azure and Microsoft in their internal cloud actually use FPGAs directly connected to the network to be able to do inferencing. And with the N3000, what Intel's actually doing is they're putting the FPGA and that 100 gig networking onto a single PCIe card that you can put into a server like the Supermicro server, and then you can either build your own IP on top of it, or you can go license IP from other vendors. So you can get things like super high speed OpenSSL acceleration is a really good example, or crypto acceleration. You can get that done by just buying an IP block, throwing this card in your server, and then having it work. So you don't have to go through the whole step of programming an FPGA. And the cool thing there is that you actually get the performance of basically a directly attached to the network FPGA without having to go all the way to the CPU. So this is a big deal for, if you think about it, service providers like we're talking about here in the 5G space, because now they can get that FPGA acceleration without having to go to an x86 CPU, without having to go buy an expensive Ericsson or another vendor's box. Of course, these cards are a lot higher power than some of the other network cards that you see, and so being able to cool that is actually one of the key capabilities of the server.
Okay.
Yeah, cool.
And can you give us some idea in terms of, are there any ways that you customize this or you built this custom, you know, for really the customers or industries that you target?
Yeah, so talking about those kind of cabinets, right? They are, the requirement is it has to be front IO. So basically for our server, the I/O has to be out front for them to be able for easy installation and the maintenance. So the box itself pushed towards the pretty end to the end of the cabinet. So it's not a racket. So the technicians wouldn't be able to go to the back and doing anything. So everything has to be in the front.
Okay.
That's a purpose one, right? And the way also, like you said, right? For Intel's N3000 FPGA card for layer one acceleration, we have to do a lot of fine tuning with that. We integrate that with our server because there's a, you know, we have solved the potential thermal issues there as well to optimize its performance.
Cool.
Yeah. So another thing, I guess you mentioned earlier, this one's CPU is a 6212U Cascade Lake. Specifically, Intel's recommend this one for the RAN type of application. Okay. So we picked this one for the 1U form factor. As far as we know, right, this one has the good performance for customers need. And we haven't seen this actually from other suppliers to our customers. That's why this particular platform is very popular now.
And that's the Xeon Gold 6212U.
Yes.
Okay, cool.
Hey guys, I hope you enjoyed this view of a system that a lot of us don't get to see on a normal basis, and a lot of folks just don't even know exists, but it's also one of the most important platforms for Supermicro and the service provider industry, the edge analytics industry. I mean, this is a big deal. Now, we focused on the N3000 FPGA here because, well, it's a cool card. We haven't been able to really cover it, so I just kind of want to show it off. But you could just as easily go throw in a GPU and do something like CUDA-based AI inferencing. And the fact that this server is short depth, it's designed to only be accessed by a single aisle instead of having to go to both aisles to service it, means that you actually get a little bit more in terms of deployment flexibility than you do off of a standard server. So I guess for our readers and those on YouTube, I guess, you know, the big takeaways are, number one, this thing's out there. But number two, if you are building and thinking about how do I go build edge platforms, this is a type of server that can actually save you a lot of space. And in a lot of deployments at the edge that weren't designed to have a traditional 3-foot or deeper rack, this is actually kind of a cool option. Hey, if you've made it this far, why don't you click subscribe, turn on those notifications so you can see the next time we come out with a new video. We're putting out new content all the time, and we're going to accelerate that in the second half of this year. As always, thanks for watching and have an awesome day.